to listen, to give this Christmas away sometime this week before practice. It's probably the hardest song we'll do this Christmas season. Give this Christmas away. Yeah, you can hand him.
Testing one.
Good morning, good morning. God is good. All the time. And for the folks that are watching on live stream, good morning to you. Welcome to Thurmont United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Ken, and I'm glad you're with us this morning. If you're new to the church, we're a Bible-based church, also a mission-minded church. 10% of all the money comes in goes back out to missions. And if you'd like to support this ministry, our address is 13880 Long Road, Thurmont, Maryland, 21788. I hope everyone had a good Thanksgiving. And then Nancy and I did. So that was awesome. Does anybody have an announcement? Any announcements this morning? Well, I've got a couple. I'm sure you have friends and family members that are very hard to buy for at this time of the year, and you're in luck because we have a church cookbook. We're selling these for $12, right? $12, the cookbook. And we also have the Cat's Meow. We're selling these for 20. So I tell you what, if you buy both, you'll get $2 off. So, but seriously, I hope that you purchase one of these and one of these. These are very nice cookbooks. I even have my famous recipe in this cookbook. Angie, you had your hand up. Thank you very much, Angie. And for those watching live stream, we're going to go Christmas caroling, as Angie Forrest reminded us, at Sunday, December 13th at 1 o'clock. And if you can come and carol with us, please let Angie Forrest know. All right. Don't forget, we have our newsletter. We just did these this week. So please grab a newsletter if you didn't get one on your way in. And you also notice there's a Christmas card box back there. You can save some money on postage by just dropping your Christmas cards to members of the congregation in the box in the back, and that way you can save postage. Anybody else have an announcement? Surely. Okay, so you folks watching online, that's Monday, December 14th, craft night at what time?
6:30.
At 6:30.
In the social hall.
In the social hall.
And there are
okay, so you need to bring a few items. So they're in your newsletter. Read the newsletter, or you can ask Shirley. Other announcements this morning? Justin. Yes. We're looking forward to 2021, yes. Amen. Does anybody else have a joy this morning? Wendy. That's good to hear, Wendy. I hope you guys did have a good Thanksgiving, and Amanda and I did. Any other joys? How about prayer concerns? Does anybody have a prayer concern this morning? Jeff?
Thank you.
looks like the doctor, we got a couple doctors in the house with Justin here, so might be calling on you here. I mean, Josh might be calling on you. I get my J's mixed up. There are so many J's. Wendy? Thank you, Wendy. Anybody else? Yeah. Doing chemotherapy?
Doing. Okay. And I guess Esther's doing chemotherapy too.
Any news, Angie, on your situation? Okay. Any other prayer requests? December the 2nd, she has surgery. Then you keep Sandy Moser and her husband Jim in our prayers. Any other? Well, Angel, do you have? Getting close. All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to gather here this morning in this beautiful sanctuary, and I thank you for the folks that decorate it. It looks beautiful as we celebrate the season of Advent, and we thank you for the many people that were here yesterday working hard to make this sanctuary beautiful as it is. Heavenly Father, we lift up our concerns to you this morning. We lift up Zach and Christy for COVID-19. We ask your Holy Spirit to be upon them, provide them strength to resist this disease and to recover. And we ask that your Holy Spirit will give their bodies the strength to overcome. And also with the Swanson family too, that they may have strength in their family and their bodies to overcome this disease, Lord. We pray for strength and healing. We also pray for Angel as it's getting close to her birth. We pray that you'll be with her, Lord, and we pray for a healthy baby girl, and we also pray that the birth will go
without any complications, Lord. We ask your Holy Spirit to guide that process. We pray for this person with a muscular dystrophy. We ask your Holy Spirit to be upon them and provide healing and strength in their body, Lord. We also lift up Sandy Moser, who's going in for surgery on December the 2nd. We pray for her, and we pray for successful surgery and recovery. We pray for her husband, Jim Moser, as well. We lift up Emily to you, who's got a new job. We ask your blessing upon her, and we pray that you'll be with her in this new adventure in her life. We pray that it goes successfully for her. We also lift up Sarah to you as she goes in for surgery for her thyroid. We ask you to guide the hands of the surgeon. We pray for successful surgery and recovery. We lift up Nicole to you as she continues to go in for chemotherapy. We ask your Holy Spirit to provide strength and healing in her body. We lift up to Angie Forrest, who's with us this morning, Lord. She's doing her best, Lord, and we ask your Holy Spirit to be upon her, provide the healing that she needs. We ask that you grant the physicians wisdom to continue to treat and diagnose, and we ask your Holy Spirit to provide strength and healing in her body, Lord. We lift up Esther, Lord, who's also doing chemotherapy. We pray for your Holy Spirit to provide strength and healing in her body, and for Joni Twigg, who suffers from chronic anxiety and chronic depression. We ask your Holy Spirit to be upon her, and we ask that we pray that she'll be open to intervention in her life. We lift up these concerns, Lord, and any others that may be on our hearts this morning, or any others that I may have forgotten. We lift up to you in a moment of silence. Lord, we thank you for always hearing our prayers. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who promised to be with us always. And in his name we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now it's time to celebrate our first Sunday in Advent, and Angie Forrest and her family is lighting our first candle for us this morning.
Lighting a candle is a simple yet profound act. It is a testimony to the power of light over darkness. Even the light of one candle can reveal our faces as we stand near the candle. As we light the candle, we begin our journey to Christmas, a day of joy and celebration. The first candle on the Advent wreath is called the Hope Candle. It opens the period that anticipates the Christmas and remembers those who first spoke the promise of the coming Christ child.
Our scripture comes from the Old Testament, Isaiah 2:2-5. This is what Isaiah, son of Amoz, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as chief among the mountains. It will be raised above the hills, and all nations will stream to it. Many people will come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways so that we may walk in his paths. The law will go out from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between the nations and will settle disputes for many peoples. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations will not take up swords against nations, nor will they train for war anymore. Come, O house of Jacob, let us walk in the light of the Lord.
Let us pray. Dear God, as we celebrate the first coming of Jesus and anticipate his second coming, help us to be awake and ready to do battle. We battle against the powers of this dark world and against the spiritual forces of evil. Clothe us with Jesus Christ, that we may walk in his light, which is able to banish the darkness. In the Savior's name we pray. Amen.
So I don't know who is the person in your house, if you do turkey, who gets up, you know, if you do the one real early in the morning. But somehow or another, through the years, I got that job. So I had to laugh this week. So Thanksgiving morning, I got up about 5:30 and got the turkey in. And when you're doing those sorts of things, you're always like, boy, I just can't wait to serve everybody today. I'm so excited. So maybe you are. That's good. I kind of get the feeling if I says Angie, I'd probably be that way because she's kind of that way. You know, she's probably yes, sort of thing. But anyway, at 5:30 in the morning, I was sort of like, you know, I should chop up the celery and the onions to make the stuffing and everything like that. So anyway, I come back and I read my devotional for the morning, and it says this: offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. I was like, wow. And I'm doing it through the Bible in a year. This isn't a Thanksgiving devotion. It just happened to be Thanksgiving. So anyway, I just thought that was kind of funny. That it's a reminder, though, through the seasons of Thanksgiving and Christmas, that what we do for God, and not to do it and complain about it, because that's not in the right spirit. And the rest of that, the next one, I think is really appropriate for this one. It says, each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. So this morning we have Julie up here and Tom on this side, and they've offered to sing and play with us. And Josh is home from college, and he said, sure, I'll play the piano for you this Sunday. So and we have everybody, Doug is learning how to play the bass, and you know, he's up here, and Justin offered to sing. So, well, Jim was going to be here, but he's quarantined, so that sort of, the devil stepped in there and snatched him on that one. So, but he's healthy at home, at least at the moment. So, but anyway, and the rest of that verse says, and this is in 1 Peter, if anyone speaks, he should do so as if speaking the very words of God. If anyone serves, he should do it with all the strength that God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Christ Jesus. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. So that's just an awesome verse. I thought God needed me to hear that during the season of the year. So. All right, we're going to sing You're Worthy of My Praise. So this isn't exactly, obviously, a Christmas song. And we'll start mixing in the Christmas songs. Obviously, as we get into season of Advent here, we'll do more and more. But this one it's not a Christmas song, obviously, but it has a Christmas message that you are worthy of my praise. So. Thank you. this Christmas carol. Come,
thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins. Release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, O above the earth thou art, dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Oh,
baby's
message this is, Lord, that you incarnate, God in man, came here to dwell. And we praise your name, Heavenly Father. We thank you that you can be here in our midst. The incredible fact that you come and live inside of us in your spirit, that we are your temple. And Heavenly Father, as we come here for you this morning, we just ask that you would open our hearts and minds to receive your word, that you would be with our pastor, that you might deliver the word of God, that we might receive it. In your name we pray, amen.
Scripture this morning is from the Gospel of St. Luke. So I'd like you to turn to in your Bible to Luke chapter 17. Luke chapter 17, and we're going to start at the 11th verse. Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go, show yourself to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back, praising God with a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Has no one returned to give thanks to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Arise and go. Your faith has made you well." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We pray that we will be grateful for all that you have given us. So many times we forget to say thank you. Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth, the meditation of our hearts, be acceptable in thy sight. And either through me or in spite of me, may your words speak to your people. In the name of the risen Christ, I pray. Amen. Do we ever take our blessings for granted? Yeah. Are we as grateful as we should be? Has there ever been a time when we've forgotten to say thank you? Sure, it happens to all of us. Sometimes we forget to say thank you in the excitement of the moment. I suspect that that may have happened to these 9 men in our gospel story. Maybe they just forgot to say thank you. Well, in today's gospel lesson, Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem, and he encounters 10 men who have leprosy. When these men see Jesus, they cry out, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." They are pleading with Jesus to heal them of this terrible disease. You know, leprosy was one of the worst things life could do to a person in Jesus' day and time. For it was a hopeless disease. Part of you actually died every day, and there was no way to treat it. And beyond the physical torment, lepers could not even count on comfort or sympathy or compassion from their friends and relatives. You see, leprosy was very, very contagious. So for the good of everybody concerned, those affected were forced to live in isolation, away, apart from their friends and family members. So here we have 10 men who were cast out of their homes, away from their families, made to wander helplessly because they were affected with this very terrible contagious disease. Jesus looks at them and tells them, go show yourself to the priests. Now, Jesus is referring to Leviticus chapter 14, verses 2 and 3, which says, what the priest is to do when he happens to come upon a leper who is healed. You see, a person who had leprosy was not allowed in the temple because they were unclean and they were contagious. But if they were cured, they were supposed to go to the priest, and the priest would do this rite of purification. And once the priest did that, they could get back into the temple. So Jesus commands them to go to the priest. Now, I'm sure that must have been very, very confusing. They asked to be healed, but Jesus tells them to go show themselves to the priest as if they've already been healed. And as they went, they were healed. Yet the text says only one turned back to give his thanks when he realized that he was healed. And praising God in a loud voice, he falls at the feet of Jesus and thanks him. And Jesus says, arise and go. Your faith has made you well. All 10 experienced the healing power of Jesus. But Luke says that Jesus spoke the words of salvation to only one of them. 9 out of the 10 kept walking. But the one, the Samaritan, came back and said, thank you. Jesus says the unexpected. He says, well, weren't all 10 healed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return thanks and praise to God except this foreigner? How could they not have been grateful? Yet, only one returned to say thank you. 10 were healed, 1 said thank you. Well, that's kind of par for the course. We see that every day in our society. So often people get what they want, and once they get what they want, they think they have no further need of God, and they forget to say thank you. Gratitude has always been rare. It is based on our decision to appreciate the world around us and not always want to bite back at the world. Gratitude does not depend on our external circumstances, nor one's lot in life. The key to gratitude is just simply to appreciate what you got, to appreciate what you have. Perhaps the most surprising thing of this story is the one that went back is the one that nobody would have expected to go back, for he was a Samaritan. The rest were Jews. To be grateful is simply to realize our need and our condition in life. We cannot be grateful unless we realize we depend upon God and we depend upon each other, our brothers and sisters. If we say that we have no sin, if we think that we're self-sufficient, then we're not going to say thank you. Many of us receive blessings from God that we're just not aware of. And sometimes we think we have just good luck. Or sometimes you might think we're at the right place at the right time. So often we're unaware of our blessings. But we can't give thanks to God if we're unaware. Unfortunately, so many people that think that they deserve what they have in life. If we feel that we deserve all that we get, we're not going to have room for gratitude. The enemy of having a grateful life is the thinking that we deserve everything. We may even think that God owes us something. But if we feel unworthy, if we acknowledge what Christ did for us, then that helps our hearts to overflow with a sense of gratitude. And faith is a necessary part of that. You notice Jesus told that man who was grateful, "Your faith has made you well." All 10 were healed, but only one was made well. The grateful man was not only healed in his body, but he was also healed in his soul. As we begin this Advent season, we remind ourselves all that we have to be thankful for. And we have a lot to be thankful for. We have this beautiful sanctuary here to give God thanks and praise. And the decorations are lovely this morning. We have many reasons. And of course, the most important reason of all, as you know, to give thanks for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Today is the first Sunday of Advent, and that's why we light that candle over there. And this season of Advent is a time for us to prepare our hearts and our minds for this season. But you know what? Getting ready for Advent is more than just getting ready for Christmas. You know, most people like myself, we haul decorations down from the attic or we haul decorations up from the basement. But being prepared for Christmas is also a spiritual matter too. Since Advent refers to the coming of Jesus Christ, the season of Advent is when we celebrate that coming. And we do that in many different ways. Do you know the prophet Isaiah was getting ready for the coming of the Messiah 800 years? 800 years before he arrived. Isaiah's prophecies were fulfilled in the first Advent, the birth of Jesus Christ. On the other hand, the complete fulfillment of God's promises concerning the last days will not come until the second advent of Jesus Christ. And that, of course, is his second coming. So Advent is not just a time to prepare for Christmas, but it's also a time to prepare, when you heard it read, when they will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Well, nations will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. But yet, if you're like me, you wonder, how can we prepare for the second advent? How can we prepare when we lack the most important detail? When's it going to happen? We're supposed to get ready, yes. And we can get ready for the first coming, Christmas Day, the birth of the Messiah. But how about the second one? How can we get ready for that one? The second advent is one for which we're not too sure when it's going to be here. For Advent is a season to help us to get ready for the first coming, but also for the second coming too. And being prepared for the second coming has a lot less to do with where we're going to be on Christmas Day, December 25th, and more to do with where we're going to spend eternity. Over the years, there have been many people who have predicted the second coming, the second advent. One of the most famous was a man in the 19th century named William Miller. William Miller spent a long time studying the Bible and what it says about the second coming of Christ. And he predicted that the second coming of Christ was between October 1943 and October 1944. And he gathered a huge following. And the closer the period approached, the more sense of anticipation became intense between him and his followers. And on the last night of the window of opportunity, some of Miller's disciples gathered on a hilltop outside of town. And they all dressed in white robes.
waiting for Jesus to appear. Now, one joker wasn't very impressed about Miller or his prediction, and he snuck up on them. And at midnight, he blew a blast on his trumpet. The believers jumped up in the air, anticipating the return of Christ. But they weren't. As you might imagine, people started thinking about this, and you would think after this event, people would stop trying to predict the second coming of Christ. But if you would think that they would stop thinking about when to make such a prediction, you know, you would be wrong. People started to figure out where Miller had gone wrong. His disciples looked over his calculations and started to revise his calculations. So they were still at it. And that's one way to handle it. That's one way people deal with it. However, many Christians, especially in the mainline Christian denominations such as us, they took a very, very different lesson away from what happened with Miller. They said to themselves, nobody's going to make us look stupid. You're not going to find me on a hilltop dressed in a white robe with some trumpet-blowing comedian making a fool out of me. So we'll just stay away from any talk about the second coming. Well, that's not the answer either. You know, C.S. Lewis talks about this in his essay entitled The World's Last Night. C.S. Lewis asked, well, what should we do if we knew that tonight would be the world's last? And his answer may surprise you. When Christ comes, Lewis says, we should be doing the task for which God has called us to do. So the emergency room nurse should be working her shift because there are going to be people hurt, even on the world's last night. The air traffic controller should be at his post because people are going to want to get home safely from their flight, even on the world's last night. So no matter what you're calling or what you're doing, you should be doing it, not standing around in some white robe on the top of a hilltop. Now, Martin Luther, the famous theologian and priest, writer of the 95 Theses, answered the same question with just a little bit different twist in his answer. He was asked, what would he do if he knew that Jesus was coming back tomorrow? And Martin Luther said, I would plant a cherry tree. Because God's purpose is not to destroy the world, but to renew it and to transform it. And somehow that cherry tree that we plant, even on the last day, will make some contribution to God's new heaven and new earth. Yet, whether Christ returns today or tomorrow or 1,000 years from now, that's really not the critical issue. Those who claim to be Christians, me and you, are to live as if Christ is coming every day. And thanks be to God. Amen. At this time, I'd like you to get out your communion kit. And actually, we have a song for you.
wash the feet of the weary, embrace the ones in need. I want to be like you, Jesus, to have this heart in me. You are the God of the humble.
Supper is over, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave the cup to the disciples and said, "Take, drink, all of you. This is my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink of it as often as you will in remembrance of me." So Henry, eat the bread and drink of the cup. Remember your life, death, and resurrection, and we look forward to your coming again. Make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one with Christians around the world, until we gather together at your heavenly banquet. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's peel off the top layer and take the wafer. The body of Christ is broken for you. Take, eat, and be thankful. Peel back the second layer. The blood of Christ shed for you. Take, drink, and be thankful. Lord, we thank you for the body and blood of Christ we just received. May it nourish our spirit. In Jesus' name, amen.
song, it really tells the story of Jesus as he came. It's called Jesus Messiah. If you want to stand.
Name above all names, blessed Redeemer.